Alright, ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the second episode of Accidental Origin. Hi, my name is Brendan, and I'm a writer. And this is the second episode of my weekly Twitch show that I've just started. I've had a good week. Been working on the show notes a bit. I did a couple of the exercises that I talked about last week, but we'll get to that more towards the end of the show. What's everyone up to? I don't know. Still working on my intro aspects. So that's me. That's what I've been up to. The first episode was, I got a lot of positive response, so I'm pretty stoked about that. But I hope we can keep that up and you and I can all learn about writing. So episode two. The second episode of this show is going to be about inspiration. As you can see on my wall there, I know it's inverted, trust me. The room looks much better inverted. For whatever reason, it's just more solid. So this is going to be the second week of pretty much all theory. We're not going to do a ton of practical stuff. We should be going into practical stuff next week. I hope. Though we might delve into that a little bit tonight. Depending on how long the content I've planned goes, I do have a backup lesson plan for more content if need be. So hopefully we won't get to that, but we'll see how it goes tonight. Second disclaimer: channel art's pretty much ready to go. I'm just ironing out the last few details with Marcus. But we should have that all up next week, I'm hoping. I'm hoping. We'll gotta let everything fall into place, but that should be how it goes. The last thing I wanted to talk about. And before I get to the last thing, I'll do kind of a silly unveiling at the beginning of the show with the logo and all that stuff when I do get all those things ironed out. So that should be good. Look forward to that. It looks fantastic. Like, really, really awesome. I'm super excited. The last thing I wanted to talk about in my disclaimer was that because this week we're going to be talking about inspiration, we're going to be talking about influences, I thought it was important to kind of bring up the idea of what people call the classics. Now, the classics are those kind of, those must-see movies, defining movies of a generation. When we talk about film, we talk about things like Citizen Kane and Birth of a Nation and Howard Hughes and like a bunch of stuff like that. Pulp Fiction, those are all considered classic films. Books are things like Wuthering Heights and anything by like James Joyce. All that stuff's considered the classics for reading, you know? So the thing I have about that is that the classics, like, when you talk about things that people have to read and all that, or have to experience, you kind of run into this problem of time, right? Not everyone has tens of thousands of hours to sit down and watch movies from 50, 60 years ago, just to sit down and do it. So I'm not explaining this point very well, but the idea that I'm trying to get across here is that when we're talking about the classics and all those things, there's hundreds of years of classics. Not necessarily in film. Film's a bit of a younger medium, but there's still over 100 years of film stuff. And no one's going to have the time to keep up with the current release content as well as the old content and all that stuff. Like, it's just too much material for any person to consume in their lifetime. So, in that vein, for the Accidental Origin experience, I'm totally not going to have seen movies that people consider classic. Not at all. But I've seen a lot of old films. Like, I'm a huge fan of Citizen Kane, but unless you're a film major, you probably have never seen that movie. Because it's from the 50s. Like, there is so much to experience, and there's no possible way for you to experience it all. So, yeah, we're gonna keep the idea of, like, oh, why haven't you seen this thing, to a minimum, hopefully. Just because, you know, it's just too much, man. Just too much. Anyway, I have no idea if I explained that properly. But I hope I got my idea across. So, yeah, today's episode is going to be about inspiration and influence. So, the reason why we're talking about these things is last week we talked about creativity. So, how to be creative, how to generate ideas, all that kind of stuff. And this week we're going to talk about inspiration, influence in sort of the next step of that process. Like, so you go from being creative and promoting creative thought to having inspiration and being influenced in how you generate those thoughts and what thoughts you generate, which then lead you to expanding on an idea, outlining an idea, making a premise, a log line, all those things that lead you to creating a story. So for me, this is the second step on the road from nothing, the blank canvas, to a finished picture. As far as inspiration goes, and creating an idea, what we have, like, two ways that you can think about it. You either have an idea, or you can generate an idea. Now, the exercises I was doing today, that I suggested last time, are a way of generating an idea. Fortunately, having an idea is just sort of like, it has to just come to you. And we talked about last week about ways that you can make that easier, like the ways that you can speed up that process of having it come to you. But yeah, it just has to come to you. But yeah, there's totally the idea of generating an idea. And last week I showed Seven Thanktum, the random generator. And that's exactly what that's for. It's for it's to use computerized randomization in order to spark some sort of flow, some sort of jumping off point, so you don't have to deal with that blank canvas. Cause I know how hard it can be to stare at that blank page and not know what to do. Like, I get it, artists get it. It's tough. It's totally tough. But yeah, like, generating an idea, jumping off points. You know, other ways are things like mind maps, stuff like writing prompts, always a good thing. Dream journals, regular journals, what if questions. Those are all good ways of generating ideas for writing a story. So, after all that preamble, I actually am going to read an excerpt from something that I wrote several years ago, my first real attempt at writing a novel, because it specifically has to do with the way in which we are inspired by our surroundings. At least, to me, that's what it's about. So yeah. Got my nice little excerpt here. So yeah, this is from my novel Fanfiction. It's called Fanfiction. I never finished it, and going back and reading it now, I feel like it's worth finishing. There's a lot of really good stuff there. It needs work for sure. But that's part of how you improve, right? I'm a different writer now than I was 2 years ago. I'm a better writer. At least I think I'm a better writer. I hope I'm a better writer. But yeah, that's part of the artist's journey, right? That constant climbing of the mountain. So, without further ado. Fanfiction. The crowd moved with a purpose that Finn definitely did not share, which is why Aaron's brisk stride soon had her putting distance between them. Not that she noticed, engrossed in the email she was checking on her phone. Finn stopped as he looked at as he looked up at the complex they were headed towards. K Network's blue and white logo stood out against the polished glass and steel. It was even more distinct from the vibrant greens of the greenery and the somber grays of the crowd. He closed his eyes and listened to the sounds of the city. Vehicles roared down the nearby expressway. The mass of people around him talked and laughed amongst themselves, passing around him as he stood. A giant video screen was mounted on the side of a squat building connecting two of the towers. News snippets, short interviews, and trailers played on loop, and added a layer of cheerful chatter and dramatic music that was slightly drowned out by all the other sounds. He felt a shiver run through him. Pieces of ideas, sparked by the background noise, began to bounce around inside Finn's head. Plots exploded as the ideas collided like atoms in a reactor. The stories burned, trying to escape their fleshy prison into the world. Unconsciously, he reached out a hand in front of him, like he thought he could grasp all the possibilities floating in the air. What ifs, prickling his skin. Finn slowly opened his eyes. His gaze darted around the mob of people, making connections and pushing more possibilities into the mass of creativity swirling inside his brain. He knew that this happened to him with new experiences, especially in unfamiliar places. His eyes snapped bright. A man in a black suit and red tie walked by. The story flowed out. The man was a mob contract killer trying to leave the scene of his latest hit. A woman in a brown motorcycle jacket passed on his left. She was a stunt woman who would eventually fall in love with the Chaebol. There were a good many more. Finn cataloged each person, each strange shadow, each reflection. He knew that he'd have to write them all down before the feelings escaped him. He might have a thing for plot and characters, but memory could be tricky, and he didn't have the greatest control on his emotions. Even the slightest output could skew the perspective enough to ruin a good idea. It wasn't like he could see all the stories clearly, either. Quite a few were just out of reach, an itch you couldn't quite scratch. But they were there, and Finn had learned to recognize the feeling of his brain making connections, processing the new input and changing the output to compensate. Those moments were just as important as the fully fleshed out stories. He swore that he could feel his perspective changing as he watched, spinning old ideas into new, better ones, and noticing trends that could change the impact of others. Writing was all about emotions, and nuances were the key. So yeah, that's an excerpt from my partial novel. And the reason I wanted to read this on stream today was to showcase a little bit of my work, stuff that I've worked on in the past, stuff that I'm improving on, as well as to kind of show you what I mean by creativity and influence and how those things can help with your writing. I talk a lot about that. Where you know, when I walk down the street, I make up scenarios of who people are and what they're doing and why they're doing it, and you know, what's their story. That guy sitting on the bus across from you is, I don't know, making this up on the fly, is on the run from government persecution and is hiding out in Canada legally in order to find some sort of piece of evidence in order to clear his name. I mean, that's a little hokey and a little maybe stereotypical, but those are the kinds of things I think about when I go places, right? You know, that person on the street has a story, has a life. They came from somewhere. They have influences. They have people they love. They have people they hate. Who are those people? Why do those people matter? How does that affect his story? Right? So those are all things that I think about when I'm trying to come up with an idea. And the best ones of those that I get when I'm walking down the street and all that, I save for later. Like I said last week. Write as much as you can down, because it'll come in handy later on, for sure. There's always something for that. So yeah, ideas and inspiration. This week I reread Brick by Brick by Steve McCraney as part of the book club, which I'll talk about at the end. But that book contained so much of what I was trying to do with this episode. I mean, I had all these points, and I read the book, and I was like, oh, this essay is this point, and this essay is that point, and this essay is this point. So obviously, in some sense, I'm on the right page, right? Like, I'm saying the things that other creators are saying, because, you know, when that many people are saying it, that means that someone's on the right track somewhere, right? There's, like I was saying last week, and I need to stop referring to last week because who knows if you even watched last week, but there's artists say the same things, they just say them in different ways, and that's 100% what I'm finding with this work, with doing Accidental Origin, is like I have all these thoughts about what I think things are, and it's awesome to see them confirmed by people who I respect and who know a lot more than I do about these topics. So I'm gonna present a little bit of what's going on in Brick by Brick, because I think it's important. And I think that it really hits nail on the head for what I'm doing with inspiration this week. So number one, or the first part I wanted to talk about, go to my main screen here.
Oops,
wrong one. And this is off Stephen McCrammy's website, and I won't go through the entire comic. I think you should all read them yourselves, but I just wanted to have something kind of up to show as I went through it. So, Taste is Your Teacher. Taste is Your Teacher is a comic essay talking about how we have to immerse ourselves in people who do what we do. You know, as a writer, I study other writers. I study people who have written for a long time. I study people who have written for a short time. I immerse myself in writing and writers. An artist would study the master, study Da Vinci, study Michelangelo, study all these people who came before you and have had impact. And as you do that, and as you study them, you can learn the tools that you need to be the type of artist you want to be. You might not know them by the same names as the masters knew them, but you'll still know them on a certain level, right? Like, you learn perspective by looking at how people do perspective. You learn lines and shape and form and value by watching people who know about those things and studying how they do them, right? So that's the biggest part of becoming inspired. You got to go out and find people who are inspiring, who do cool things that you can learn from. And so as you do this, you're gonna find that your art is not great. It's not. The more you have a taste for great art, the less that you're going to think that your art is great. And that's true. And there's nothing wrong with that. The thing that Stephen talks about, and that I am, like, this specific comic, this essay, has inspired me for years upon years before I even found who rediscovered who Stephen McCraney was. I had had this comic on my desk for ages, and basically the idea of Be Friends with Failure is your art is not great compared to those masters, but those masters have probably failed more times than you've even tried. And I said this last week, and I'll say it again 1,000 times, but failure is the first step of learning. And that's what this talks about. Those masters have failed more times than the beginners even tried. So you can't hold yourself to the same standards as them. That's not to say that aesthetically you can't strive to be like them. That's just saying that until you've put in the time, you can't really compare yourself to those people. Just like you can't compare a baby learning to talk to a fully grown adult. You don't tell a baby it sucks because it can't talk yet. It's learning. You're an art baby. You're learning. There's a process. There's a whole set of things involved that you need to improve on. So be friends with failure. Make him your buddy. Learn. Be better. Look at those great artists. Be inspired. Learn things. You'll be better for it. So, on that note, the third part of Brick by Brick that I wanted to talk about today is that, well, this is the panel I want, is the art of stealing. In the essay here is entitled Practice Does Not Make Perfect. But I wanted to talk about a specific aspect of that. Stephen's broader point is that practice does not make perfect, practice makes permanent. Right? So, when we talk about that, that means if you have bad habits, they're going to be ingrained in you if you practice them. And that's totally true, because, oh my god, do I have bad habits with stuff? Yeah, man, do I have bad habits. But the important thing that you gotta take out of this essay is the art of stealing. That sounds really weird. Brendan, why the art of stealing? We don't want to steal. We want to be original. We want to be creative. We want to be all these things. And it's like, yeah, I get that. I get that. I totally get that. But, as the great Pablo Picasso once said, good artists copy, great artists steal. And what he means by that is that, I keep saying that, what he means is that we can imitate as much as we want. And it'll be nothing more than a replication, a duplication, a copy of what someone else has done. When you steal, that's a deliberate intent in order to learn. Like, you're making a deliberate intention to do a study, to see why someone did something. What's the formula for how they got there, you know? An imitation is, you'll learn how to imitate, but you won't learn how the whole thing is formulated, how it's all put together. When you study a painting and you do a copy of a painting, like, you don't, if you're just doing the copy, you just make it look the same. You're not learning the brush strokes. You're not learning why did he do a perspective this way? Why did he do it that way? How can I do those things, and how can that help inform my own style? Right? So that's what I mean when I talk about stealing. The difference of imitation versus inspiration. You know, like, these people are awesome and we can learn so much from them, but you gotta learn from them in the right ways. And I've seen a lot of stuff on Twitch with artists talking about, oh, I don't like it when people copy me, or I love it when people copy me, and all this stuff. And I think both perspectives are valid. But at the same time, it depends on how they're learning when they copy you, right? And this is a big part of being a writer, especially, though we look at it a little bit of a different way. The way that I look at it is that I look at it in terms of how do people construct story? What are genre tropes? What are interesting ways that they've done that type of setting? Because I'm going to say it now, and I'm probably going to be flamed for saying it, but there's no such thing as an original idea. Everything good has already been thought of. What there is there's an original presentation of an unoriginal idea, which is not the same thing, but you can definitely do that. And the way that we do that is by gathering all these little pieces from other things and building them together to create a new thing. And that goes directly back into my next point, which is Stephen, the master that he is, or master that I think he is, talks specifically about this, and is that there are three steps to imitation, three ways to imitate. The first way is called the naturalist. Now, the naturalist, get this thing here, the naturalist goes out and sees the beauty in its habitat, and you record its movement, and you have to kind of sit there and create a hypothesis that accounts for what you're seeing. You gotta look for patterns. You gotta observe. You gotta correlate. You gotta connect those dots that have never been connected before. Thinking outside the box. And I see you talking about that there, Baseman. Like, yeah, and I honestly believe that. But that doesn't mean that what you do can't be interesting. It just means that you have to know that your stuff's going to be compared to everyone else's stuff. I mean, I don't think I've had a conversation about writing where someone, either me or whoever I was talking to, didn't say, oh, that kind of sounds like this. And I'm like, yeah, I mean, it kind of does. In fact, I mean, when you're doing television and film pitches, and this is stuff I learned in school, when you're doing television and film pitches, they still do it now in Hollywood a lot, though not as much, I think, as they used to. But it's kind of this idea of it's X meets Y with this twist. So it's like, it's Jaws meets Twister. That's what Sharknado is, right? Like, that's the way that Hollywood kind of does it. Like, or at least the way that they used to do it a lot. You know, that's how you have to present your thing. So, you know, when I was working on my show, it was like, it's Game of Thrones meets Boardwalk Empire. Right? Like, that's the way that that those creative types think about these things. So, it's okay that there's no original ideas. It's just, you kind of have to get out of there and like see where your influences are and see what other people are doing. Oh yeah, and there's totally something to be said about doing research. That being said, I don't do a ton of research on specific topics when I do it, because I find I get too influenced by other things. But I will do some research on a basic level. Right, there's a happy medium. So yeah. Oh yeah, and by the way, Derek, thanks for pointing that out. This is basically my podcast. That's pretty much the style I was going for here. And thanks for the host. So yeah, first step, the naturalist. The second step, the scientist. Once you have a hypothesis, you test it. You fail. You learn. You sit down and you evaluate why it did or didn't work. Because it's one thing to fail, but the important learning step is the second step after failing is the first step of learning. The second step is figuring out why you failed. Right? Because it's that process that makes you better. It's that constant self-study that makes you better. And as much as I don't like the peer-reviewing process, science is very much that way, where anything you publish has to be reviewed by several other people and validated, right? So if you failed, it has to be validated by other people to show that you actually made proper conclusions, that you actually learned something. And I don't really agree with the peer review process in the total of academics, but there are certain situations where it certainly works. But that's a whole other thing. And I will talk about that ad nauseum on stream. where it's more relevant, but yeah, there's certainly something to be said. Then, number three is the DJ. And this is the part that I like, and the part that I really am in tune with, I think. Play with what you discover. When you make your conclusions about why you fail or didn't fail, play with it. Try things. Try new things. If something failed and you figure out, my character was weak. Well, what character would work? Would this character work? Would that type of character work? Would a gender swap work? Like, once you figure it out, play with it. Like, determine where you can try things and try lots of things. Because again, even if you fail, learn something from it, right? And that's the kind of thing, right? And Steven here talks about he likes drawing his characters using other artists' styles because it forces you to think about certain aspects and remix them, put them out in a different way. And I hadn't thought about it before right now, but basically what he's saying is make fan art. Draw someone else's character in your own style. Draw lots of other characters in your own style. See how your style adapts to those things. Study how why they made certain aesthetic decisions. Why they constructed a story in a certain way. Right? Those are things you can learn. And as much as I laugh about it and all that, like, oh, I got my start in fan fiction, how embarrassing. There is a certain world in fan fiction that's really good at stuff like this, where they're not afraid to try weird plots and messed up characters and situations that would never logically occur just to see what would happen. And that's why I still read fan fiction to a certain extent, is because of that thing. Right? So there's a whole world of stuff that you can experience and play with. So do it. Fail. Failure is the first step of learning. Ask questions. Observe the world around you. You will be a better artist, a better writer for it. So, on that note, we're gonna have fun time. I'm gonna open up another window here. I have a whole bunch of places to go to. We're gonna talk about a little bit here. So I'm gonna open up the first couple. First two are art places. Here. So this is ArtStation, and I know people who follow Derek's stream know ArtStation. I certainly know ArtStation. ArtStation is a place for artist portfolios. You can just spend time learning, studying, immerse yourself. Figure out why are these images so cool? What works? What doesn't work? How could you improve on it? How could you make your own style better because of something that they're doing? Are they using a certain brush? Are they using a certain lighting? Are they using whatever, right? Like, those are all things that you can think about. And again, DeviantArt, the big one. Been around a long time. But there's plenty of stuff on here that's the same way, though. I think DeviantArt is a little bit more abstract at times. But that's okay. Abstract is good. I talked about this a little bit in my prep stream when I was doing some tests and stuff earlier, but it's important to be multidisciplinary, or at least to study multiple disciplines. You don't have to be good at them, but being able to see them really shows, like, it can influence your work heavily, right? Knowing how architecture works can make you a good painter, because you can paint backgrounds really, really well, because all your buildings will look fantastic. Studying sculpture changes how your lines are and all that stuff. For me, I study fan fiction, I read comics, I rewatch movies, I read scripts, I read plays. I look at art. I study art. I spend most of my time with art streamers, not writers, writing streamers. Because there's aspects of the process that are the same, and there are aspects that are completely different. Like, this time a year ago, I would not know anything about value and the way that color works and how color values work. I mean, I'm pretty much just repeating the same thing, but, like, there are so much you can learn about how that applies to other things. So now I think about it in ways of writing, right? Like, how can I add those broad colors and then give them this nice accent when it comes to my writing? When I construct a paragraph, when I construct a setting. What draws the eye when I describe the setting? Because those are the details that are important. Those ones that draw the eye, right? I mean, I'm a visual writer, I'm a visual storyteller, like, that's what I'm good at. So, and well, I mean, that's what I studied. So I think very heavily in terms of visuals and in terms of film shots and, like, all that kind of stuff. But there's aspects of those things that can really help influence your writing, help influence your art. So then I'm going to pop up some more stuff here. Fanfiction.net, the granddaddy of fanfiction. I used to be on here a lot. I don't come on here nearly as much. But I used to a lot. I actually kind of like this other site a little bit better, because it's a little bit laxer on its content rules, which I prefer. I prefer having a little bit less censorship. Also, I like reading mature things. That's just personal preference. I'm an adult. I can make those decisions. But yeah, this is just a whole different type of community. But they both do a lot of similar things. Also, being able to find things with tags and all that is really cool for fanfiction. It makes things a little bit different. You can stumble on a lot of stuff that you wouldn't necessarily stumble on just because it has related things to other stuff you liked. So yeah. Then there's places like Wattpad, that mobile writing place. I haven't been on there yet. I know some people who do. It seems interesting. It seems a lot like these kind of places. You learn a lot. You can go to Sanctum Sanctum. You can go to the library. Go to the library, choose a random section, pick something up. Read it. Don't read all of it. Just read some of it. Expand yourself. Right? So then, as part of that, I'm going to talk about something Stephen talked, but I don't have a panel open for this one, but what's called artistic lineage. And artistic lineage is looking at the people who influenced you, and then look at the people who influenced them. And then if you can still go further back, the people that influence them. You're being influenced. You're being inspired by certain people who are influenced and inspired by other people. And you can go back and you can look at those other people and say, oh, well, this is what they took from that. Here's what I could take from that. And do a wholly different thing with the same source, with a similar structure, with a similar whatever. Like, there are lots of parts of that. And I see that all the time, because, like, the next segment of the stream, like, once I'm kind of done this point, and there's a few questions in the chat that I'm going to get to in a minute, I'm going to talk about my influences, or, like, five of my influences, and there are people that I'm super inspired by that influence my influences. Right? Like, that sounds really weird and topsy-turvy, but there's totally that. There's so much you can learn. And that's why, like, art teachers... and I did study a bit of fine art and architecture and art history and all that as part of the film classes I had to take. So I do know a little bit about this, but not so much about more, like... I know more about art history than I know about, like, technique. Well, maybe not anymore, but half a dozen of one, six of the other, you know, whatever. But that's why it's important to look at the old masters. And I know at the beginning of the show, I kind of had this speech about, like, there's not enough time to experience all the classics, and there isn't. But focused browsing of those things can be really, really beneficial for you. I love Citizen Kane. Citizen Kane is a fantastic film. It is sometimes considered the best film of all time. Almost nobody I've ever met has actually seen it. Even people who grew up in that era. And that's unfortunate, but at the same time, that's the way it is. Right? Like, that's why saying things like, oh, it's a classic, it's hard, it's a modern classic. All that stuff. But there's tons of things that I think are classic, which you haven't experienced either. Like, I don't know, like Osamu Tezuka, or Yoshihiro Tatsumi, who I'm going to talk about later, and like all this stuff. So yeah, that's influences. That's inspiration. These are the people you look up towards. These are the people you can learn from. So yeah, that's all I got for part one, which is good because we're about an hour in, which is kind of where I wanted this to be. So Baseman's been asking me some questions, so I'm going to answer those. He says, this really makes me think about whether or not I worked enough on my manuscript, as I only had 6 months to write it. And the answer is, I don't know. But that being said, the amount of time it takes is not an indicator of how good or bad something is. I've worked on stuff for months, and it's not nearly as good as stuff I worked on for 6 weeks. The strength of your idea and the strength of your project is not made or break. Is not make or break by the amount of time spent on it. What matters is the quality of the idea and the quality of time spent on it. Right? I mean, a couple weeks ago when Derek restarted Leviosa, which was an image he was working on, he spent a solid week doing nothing but focus streams and worked on it 3-4 hours a day for every day. And in that week, he had a substantially more solid image than the one that he spent like almost a month and a half on. Previous to that. So, I reiterate, It's not about the amount of time you spent. It's about the quality of the time you spent. And I actually saw a thing about the Geek and Sundry book publishing contest earlier today. I have not looked at it. It depends when the due dates are, because I don't know if I have anything that's like really ready yet. Like a substantial enough draft to be ready for submission. But I will certainly take a look at it. Because, you know, opportunities are opportunities. And if you don't take the time to even look, you may never know, right? So yeah, I'm going to take a 5-minute break right about here and come back. Well, yeah, about 5 minutes. I'm going to come back around 8 o'clock and we're going to start part two, and it's going to be over on the couch, which should be fun. I might have to do some audio fandangling because I'm not entirely sure if my mic's going to pick me up. Which I should have tested this morning, but I kind of forgot. So, oops. Anyway, we'll see how it goes. If not, I'll just come back to the desk and we can talk about it here. So yeah, going to a break. There's my mouse. Do-do-do. Breaks. Okay, I'm coming back. I'm going to the couch. Writing couch. Oh, weirdness. Can you all hear me? Yeah, this is the couch on the other side of my office. I don't know how the audio is because the mic's kind of on the other side of the room right now. So I might have to make some adjustments. Sorry, I should have tested this out a lot more. But I'm just like, oh no, I'll do it live. It's fine. It'll all work. The lighting looks good. It's all good. Yeah, this will show me. Speaking of which, I have my tablet here so I can see the chat and all that from over here because I don't really have a computer monitor. So I wanted to talk a little bit about my influences, and I took a bunch of stuff off my bookshelf to show you guys. Waiting just to see if the audio is good. We good? We good, chat? How we doing? Yeah, we're good? Okay. As long as you can hear me. So yeah, I wanted to talk about a few of my influences, people who inspire me, just to give some examples and expand on some context for some of the things I've said so far.
So in I'm going to do them in alphabetical order by first name, just because that's the way I organize them. So, yeah, it's not particularly in a reference order. So, yeah, I'm going to start with this guy. Oh, actually, I wanted to talk a little bit about this first. So this is Flight. It's the first of 8 volumes. I think it's 8. Anyway, it's actually an anthology comic book with each story revolving around the idea of flight. It's got 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, 12, 14, 16, 18, 20, 21 different artists in it. Yeah, and it's fantastic. It all revolves around the idea of flight. Like, look at this. Look at that. It's so cool. And things like this are really, really awesome when it comes to talking about inspiration. Partly because an anthology is a really interesting way to present, is a really interesting way for you to come up with a prompt, an idea, something, a setting. So like these all revolve around flight and different ideas about flight, and not all of them are about actually flying in like an airplane or having wings or certain things. Like, there's a lot of different ways in which they explore the idea of flight. And anthologies like this are really, really cool when it comes to being a creative person, because like you don't have to think up flight. You just got to think about what would you say about flight, right? Like, what would I say about flight? You know, that feeling of freedom, the idea of working on an aircraft. I was in the Air Cadets growing up. I've flown on a ton of different types of planes, both two-seaters all the way up to jumbo jets. Like, I've been on tons of different types of planes. Even some I've worked on planes, like building them. More than one, in fact. So there's all kinds of really cool aspects that I can think of from my own personal experience as to what flight really means. And that's why anthologies are really cool. And if you have a bunch of artist friends or a bunch of writer friends, and you can get together and do an anthology all about a similar topic, that can lead to some awesome, awesome creativity and awesome ideas. And it's totally worthwhile. Totally worthwhile. So yeah, Flight. I quite recommend it. There's like 8 volumes. I just wanted to talk about inspiration and all that stuff. As I keep reiterating that I wanted to talk about that. So, number one, the first person on my list is Alan Moore. So I guess, yeah, a brief overview. Of my 5 influences, 3 of them are comic book writers. 2 of them are also comic book artists. There's 1 novelist and 1 screenwriter in the list. So, yeah, there's a bit of a diversity there. I tried to not just pick, like, oh, my 5 favorite comic book writers, or, like, my 5 favorite novelists, or, like, something like that. I wanted to have a little bit of diversification. So number one is Alan Moore, a very, very famous comic book writer. I describe him as a Yeti wizard, because that's basically what he looks like, and he's totally a wizard. Like, I didn't say that, like, he said that. Anyway. He's British, he's like 6'5" or something. Sorry, grab the water. He's like 6'5", and yeah, has the craziest beard and hair, like, way, way, like, down to here, like, crazy hair. just lumbers everywhere. And he's written some of the best regarded comic books in history. Well, I guess graphic novels is the better term for it. So he wrote Watchmen. He wrote V for Vendetta, From Hell. The movie with Johnny Depp was actually based on one of his graphic novels. Which is actually what this is from. This is the companion book to From Hell. I don't actually own a copy of From Hell, surprisingly. But the companion book I did buy because it's really, really cool. And I'm going to dive into that a little bit in a second. He also wrote The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen, The Killing Joke, the Batman story. Super, super cool. Like, that's what inspired Heath Ledger's Joker in The Dark Knight, right? And they even use some of the art on it for the tattoos on Jared Leto's version of the Joker. Yeah, so yeah, that Alan Moore, he wrote for 2000 AD, which I really liked. I really liked his 2000 AD stuff. The Ballad of Hayley Jones, D.R. and Quinch, Promethea, Top 10, all this really cool stuff, and a variety of genres, variety of styles, all very gritty explorations of certain types of things. One of the reasons I really like him is because of his panel construction and the way that he uses panels to pace his story. He's one of the few people I've seen who use a 9-grid layout, like a 3x3, all equal squares sort of layouts. And it's super interesting when you kind of break that down into very, very short story segments. He's also one of, like, the way that he describes to his artists, his panel layout is super symmetrical. Like, he does symmetrical panel layouts. He doesn't have asymmetrical anything. It's all very square. And it's really neat because it's so different for being square. I kind of love it. And the stories he writes and the way that he explores characters is super intense all of the time. But if you ever get to read an Alan Moore script, like one he wrote for one of his comics, and do it, because it gets a little crazy in all of the best ways. So that's why I have the companion, because it actually has parts of the script in it. So I'm gonna pull up, where is it? Where are we now? All right. So here's page one, panel one, From Hell, by Alan Moore, drawn by Eddie Campbell, who's also very awesome. Okay, let's get out there and win one for the Ripper. Actually, that Robert's Block joke, but I thought I'd stick it in anyway. This first page has 9 evenly spaced panels, all taken from a fixed point of view. Year is 1923, and we're in Bournemouth, down on the beach quite close to the tide line. The month is September. A laden, outcast day with a blind white sky and gray tides sulkily coming into damp sand of a pale gray beach. The time is late afternoon or early evening, and if we could see the sun, it would be going down. As it is, the sun sinks unseen and without spectacle behind the smothering, featureless duvet of cloud. Its only visible effect is that throughout this entire 8-page episode, the light gradually worsens through dusk to the beginnings of darkness. We are looking down from the beach, looking along the edge of the tide from a ground-level viewpoint. To the right of the picture, stretching away towards the distance, we see the great black waves washing sluggishly in with their skirts of grubby white foam. To the left, we have a smoky impression of the granite seawall and the buildings of the Bournemouth seafront rising up stolidly behind it. And then it goes on and on. The first panel is almost 2,000 words. And it's written in all caps all of the time. Alan Moore only writes in caps. I've never seen a script where he didn't write in caps. And that first panel is a third of the page. It all astounds me to read his scripts. Like, they're ridiculous craziness. But he is a brilliant writer. And, I mean, I talked about a lot of the ones that he's written that have had movie adaptations. Like, that's a solid, you know, 6-7 movies based on his work alone. And not even some of his best work, per se. But just stuff that people have adapted. So that's Alan Moore. The next person I want to do is Brent Weeks. Brent Weeks. The Way of the Shadows, the Night Angel trilogy. Which is what I have here. I also have the graphic novel, though it's still on the shelf. There's a graphic novel adaptation of The Way of the Shadows. Which I also really liked for completely different reasons. And it was super fascinating to read. But I'll get back to that. So Brent Weeks is an American fantasy writer. He's written about 7 books since he first published The Way of Shadows in 2008. I read them in 2010, all 3 of them. I haven't read the second series he started writing, which is the Lightbringer series. I do have a couple of them, but I haven't read them yet. I really want to, and I should get around to it. And Brent Weeks' website is actually the person who introduced me to graphic audio, which is the coolest audiobook group I've ever seen, where they have full narration with character voice actors and sound effects and music, and like it's a full setup, like radio drama for doing audiobooks, and it's just unbelievable. And the version of the Night Angel trilogy that they do is one of their best things that I've ever seen from them. It adds so much more grit and interesting things and tension to all of the written passages. And the reason I really like Brent Weeks is because his worlds, like, are full of life. Like, they don't feel like traditional fantasy worlds. They feel like they breathe, like they have an actual society that's based on a certain set of codes or practices. And it's filled with good people who do bad things and bad people who do good things, and crazy magic killers who are plagued by decisions and are betrayed by their magic, and like all kinds of ridiculous, amazingly well-done fantasy things that just always inspire me. So I'll read a passage from that, just because I read the Alan Moore thing and now I kind of feel like I have to. So I'll read the first paragraph here. Azoth squatted in the alley, cold mud squishing through his bare toes. He stared at the narrow space beneath the wall, trying to get his nerve up. The sun wouldn't come up for hours and the tavern was empty. Most taverns in the city had dirt floors, but this part of the Warrens had been built over marshland, and not even drunks wanted to drink standing ankle-deep in mud. So the tavern had been raised a few inches on stilts and floored with stout bamboo poles. Coins sometimes dropped through the gaps in the bamboo, and the crawlspace was too small for most people to go after them. The guild's bigs were too big, and the littles were too scared to squeeze into the suffocating darkness, shared with spiders and cockroaches and rats and the wicked half-wild tomcat the owner kept. So, Night Angel trilogy, fantastic. Love it to death. I've read this like 3-4 times now. I've read the graphic novel. I've listened to the audiobooks. All good. All good all the time. Next is Jeff Lemire. I think it's Lemire. I've never heard anyone pronounce it, unfortunately. This is a copy of The Underwater Welder. One of his original graphic novels. Really, really like this. So Jeff Lemire's Canadian. He's actually from just outside Toronto. He still lives in the Toronto area, the GTA. He's got a really cool style. I don't know if you could really tell from the cover page, but like his characters are very, very interesting in the way that he draws them. Because he also illustrates. Not everything he does. He's primarily a writer, but he also illustrates some of his own work, mostly. So his notable stuff are the independent comic book Sweet Tooth. He did a 6-issue miniseries called Trillium, which was really, really cool. The Underwater Welder, the Essex County Trilogy, which was kind of the first thing he ever did, which put him on the map. And he's actually really famous right now for his run on Animal Man when the DC Universe rebooted itself in the New 52. His run on Animal Man was super well achieved. And it was really, really cool because it explored superheroes in this very interesting way, especially because there was a lot of... like magic and mystery and mythology and all kinds of stuff mixed into it that I thought really, really complemented the superhero aspects. So the things that I like about Jeff Lemire are, I love his unique art style. It doesn't look very good all of the time, but it's really easy to tell his characters apart, despite how stylized it is. And he communicates his story very, very well. He knows how to construct good panels and interesting covers and uses art style effectively to his advantage. His works are really experimental. They're kind of weird. They're filled with like unrecognizable monsters and nothing is quite what it seems. And I really am inspired by him, and he's a fellow Canadian, and I love that. I'd like to do some of the stuff that he does. There's Jeff Lemire. I don't have anything to read from him, because he doesn't really have any prose, unfortunately. And comics don't really read well on screen. unless they're actually up. So we're gonna jump to Yoshihiro Tatsumi. Who's probably my favorite manga artist of all time. Easily my favorite manga artist of all time. He's the godfather of a Japanese manga form called Gekiga, which is technically not manga, but kind of is, because it's sort of the... It was an alternative form of Japanese comics that was trying to compete with manga in the fact that it was trying to be for adults and not for kids and not whimsical, which is kind of what manga really means. He brought this really cool cinematic flair, cinematic pacing to his work. He was inspired by Osamu Tezuka, but later went on to inspire Osamu Tezuka with his later works. And I love Osamu Tezuka, don't get me wrong, but he's such a big name that I kind of wanted to talk about some of the littler people to start with, especially in terms of manga. And A Drifting Life, which is what I have here, by Yoshihiro Tatsumi. I actually have all of Yoshihiro Tatsumi's books that were translated into English, except for one. But I have the redone version of it. I don't have the older version. Yoshihiro Tatsumi. This is a semi-autobiographical version of his life. It won a bunch of Eisners. It's actually published by a Canadian comics publisher, Drawn and Quarterly, based out of Montreal, who published a lot of really cool indie comics. And are probably the coolest comics publisher in Canada. Probably. Tatsumi wrote this. He wrote Black Blizzard, a book called Falling Words, which was an exploration of Japanese spoken storytelling traditions. Banned in the Olden Tokyo, one of his short story collections, like one of his short comic collections. The Pushman Out of Stories, another short comic collections book. Reading A Drifting Life when I was in college, like, it was the first time that I felt like someone understood me as a writer. And, that really, like, got, like, really helped form the way that I approach my writing now. where he talks about how he changed his style from that manga style into the way that he wanted to tell stories, and that helped me learn and adapt my own style, so I could tell my own types of stories, my own experiments, and all that stuff. And he's very, very humanistic. No topic is too risque. Stuff that he covers in his books are like incest, bestiality, rape, war, disease, depression, alcoholism, like working class versus upper class. Like he covers everything. Everything. And yeah, just explorations of the human psyche, what it means to be an animal, like, yeah, just, I know I have like this blank look on my face where I'm just reminded of all of the different storytelling aspects that I love about these people that I'm talking about. I forgot to go get it because I have a DVD copy of it downstairs. But the fifth person on my list is Zach Helm. And I realize that not many people are going to recognize the name Zach Helm compared to some of the other names on this that I've talked about. But Zach Helm is an American writer and film director. His two like major Hollywood movies that he wrote. So he's written two plays and two films. Or sorry, two plays and four films. But two of the films were made for TV, and then two of them were actually theatrical pictures. And the two theatrical pictures are actually probably what you've heard of, but you wouldn't have necessarily associated them with Zach Helm. So Zach Helm wrote Stranger Than Fiction and Mr. Longoria's Wonder Emporium, which are two very drastically different movies, but do explore very similar themes. I don't know a ton about Zach Helm, mostly because there's not a ton about him on the internet. He's pretty private. He's not necessarily an A-list guy like someone like Goyer or like those other big-name cinema writers, Joss Whedon, who I really like, and a few others. But yeah, Zach Helm loves the comically bizarre. He loves talking about humanity. He likes talking about learning about your humanity. His characters love, live, learn. They're each their own special snowflake. They have their own tics that make them unique, that make them kind of jump off the screen. We had to read a copy of his script for Stranger Than Fiction in class, and it was super cool because it kind of broke the mold entirely and had all these music annotations for things he wanted in the soundtrack, like throughout the script. And that's not done in a traditional Hollywood script. And I don't think they got all of them, but they did get some of them. They did get some of those tracks. They licensed them and used them in the film. And that's why you kind of have that like interesting like sort of punk rock, alt rock going along behind it, behind Stranger Than Fiction. And I just love the way that he does premises. Like, Stranger Than Fiction is such a cool premise about a guy who realizes he's a character in a novel and try and find the author who's writing him because he's a real person. And he doesn't want the plot of the novel to kind of fall out around him. Mr. McGorman's Wonder Emporium, a magical toy shop with a magical toy owner. Who teaches the people who work and are around his shop, and just so whimsical and fantastic modern fantasy aspects to them. So yeah, I really like that kind of stuff. So yeah, those are like the things I like. I read a lot of graphic novels. I read a lot of manga. I read a lot of fantasy novels, science fiction novels. I need to read more short stories. I've been wanting to for a long time, especially because I've been writing more short stories, and I kind of need to. But yeah, I need to read more short stories. have a whole smack of books I need to read. But yeah. Yeah. Like I said, you can't get to all the classics, right? You just gotta do what you can to read things that are gonna inform you. So there's all that. I'm gonna jump back into the computer. Maybe see if I can pull up a couple of things. Because I have a little bit of extra time that I didn't think I would have. So I'm gonna pull up a couple more things just to talk about.
Yeah. So I did pretty much all of that without actually looking at the video preview screen, so I hope I was like positioned correctly in the camera, because otherwise that would suck. I really hope so. Maybe talk a little bit about more. I told myself I wasn't going to, but I'm going to anyway, just because I have extra time and I really want to. So I'm going to pull out some stuff here. Move this. And I got to change this, unfortunately, because it looks so much better. Okay, there we go. So, like I said earlier, when I was talking about Yoshihiro Tatsumi, I'm a huge Osamu Tezuka fan. And Osamu Tezuka is the godfather of manga. He's the guy who put manga on the map. He's known for, his most famous character is Astro Boy. So if you've seen any of that stuff, especially the old school animation and all that, that's all really cool. He did like a biopic of Buddha, like a biographic novel of Buddha in a bunch of parts. He did Kimba the Lion. He did these, which I'm gonna talk about a little bit. So, yeah, no kidding. I also talk really loud, which probably doesn't help, but probably also makes it clearer to hear me, I hope. I don't think it's as bad as Derek's echo, though, because I think my room is a little bit smaller. But, you know, it is what it is. So this year is MW, and this year is the Ode to Kirihito. These are two of Osamu Tezuka's much later works, which are a lot less childlike. They're actually two of the most cited works when you talk about Osamu Tezuka writing in a more Gekika style. There's totally that. And Sam just sent me a picture, which I got. Let's pull that up there. Boom. Astro Boy. The iconic Astro Boy. Osamu Tezuka. Huge fan of Osamu Tezuka. These two are fascinating explorations of what it means to be a monster. Which is a topic that I am super fascinated by. I think it's one of the strengths of Frozen. I love Godzilla, the remake of Godzilla, for this exact sort of thing. The remake of Godzilla was directed by Gareth Edwards, if I'm not mistaken. Let me just double check that real quick. Godzilla. Yes, it was directed by Gareth Edwards. So Gareth Edwards wrote this really cool movie called Monsters, which I loved, which did a lot of similar things and why he got the Godzilla gig. But yeah, I love Monsters. It's super cool. What else? What else am I thinking about? So yeah, Osamu Tezuka basically defined manga style for very many years. And he's also one of the people who... he founded a lot of the animation studios in Tokyo, as well as a lot of the publishers. Like, he was a direct influence on how they got started. So he kind of, in many ways, basically built the industry on his own back. And his story is very fascinating because he was actually a doctor. He was a trained doctor and he decided to not do that and do art. And I might talk a little bit about Hayao Miyazaki because I love him too. As sort of part of that, Hayao Miyazaki's style is very much influenced by Osamu Tezuka. They have very, like, the way that Miyazaki draws characters, you can definitely draw correlations between that. The last interesting thing I wanted to say about Osamu Tezuka is that he did this really cool thing where basically, because his style was so simplistic, he had basically what we would call a cast of characters. So he drew a fat character, and he drew like a skinny character, and he drew like a boy character. And those characters played the same roles in many of his different works. So in a lot of ways, he was casting those characters with those visual stereotypes and stuff as actors throughout his work. And that's a really neat approach to the way that artists draw things. Because he understood the limitations of his style in a lot of ways, and he used it to his advantage. I'm a huge fan of Osamu Tezuka. I own like 12 of his graphic novels, something like that. I've read more. Can't recommend him enough. There's a reason he's the Godfather. There's a reason, and it's well deserved. I was watching something the other day. I was reading about Journey to the West, because we were talking about it a little bit at work, me and Sam, as well as Derek was talking about it that week as well. So we're talking about Osamu Tezuka. We're talking about Journey to the West. And Journey to the West was... there's a version of Journey to the West that Osamu Tezuka did the character designs for. It's called Alakazam the Great in English. I actually own it on VHS, and I didn't know he had worked on it. Though thinking about it now, I realize I can draw the connection between the character design. But that movie is actually credited with being the thing that got Osamu Tezuka into animation in the first place, like the reason he wanted to do an Astro Boy cartoon and all that stuff, which is super cool. It was actually a really cool version of Journey to the West. I really like it. It's called Alakazam the Great. I do know the Kingdom of Dreams and Madness. It's on Netflix, is it not? It just got put up on Netflix. I have saved it to my list. I'm going to watch it. Because I do really like Studio Ghibli. I do really like Studio Ghibli. Oh, why didn't I think of it? I talked about Zach Helm. This will be the last influence I talk about, and then I'm going to take another break. But, I'm not surprised it's a weird movie, because Hayao Miyazaki is not a normal person by any stretch. So, you know. And his art style reflects that in the way that he constructs his movies. His team is very fascinating because they actually they worked on a couple of movies before they became Ghibli. So actually, Nausicaa and the Valley of the Wind is not actually a Ghibli film, though it's considered a Ghibli film, because basically all of the main people who worked on it left that company a couple years later and became Ghibli. But yeah, Nausicaa is not actually a Ghibli film. So yeah, you can kind of see that transition, and Nausicaa is pretty different from some of the other ones in terms of its pacing and the way that it explores themes. So the last person I'm going to talk about is Akira Kurosawa, the legendary Japanese director, which I'm not sure if anyone will actually know when I talk about him. But Akira Kurosawa directed a bunch of movies. His three big ones that I know, like big ones that I like off the top of my head, Seven Samurai, which inspired an anime and like a bunch of other stuff, the movie Ran, and the movie Rashomon, all of which are very big staples in film studies classes. For a lot of different reasons, but Akira Kurosawa is a fantastic director. My personal favorite movie by him, because I have seen Ran, I have seen Rashomon and all that stuff. I haven't seen Ikiru, which I want to see, which is kind of his weird exploration of like black and white weirdness. But the movie I really like by him is Throne of Blood, which is actually a Shogun era Japanese adaptation of Shakespeare's Macbeth, done entirely in black and white. It's very, very cool the way that he does cinematography. He's inspired generations of filmmakers, including myself, though I wouldn't necessarily consider myself a filmmaker. Akira Kurosawa, one of my favorite directors. Throne of Blood. Fantastic. It's one of those things where you can kind of see how Shakespeare's stories can really be pulled out of the time period that they were written in and still function very, very well. Cool. All right, I'm going to take another 5-minute break. And I'm going to come back and I'm going to talk about the exercises I did today, showcase those a little bit, and I'm going to talk about the book club, and then we're going to do some Q&As and revision and stuff. So yeah, I'm going to take another break here. Cool. All right, I am back. I am very pleased that I have not dropped any significant amount of frames, despite how ridiculous it was streaming earlier today. I actually put the settings back up to where they should be. None of the 720 noise. I don't deal with that. Anyway. So, what do I have here? Show notes. Gotta love show notes. There we go. Other side there. Those show notes. So yeah, a few of the people here, in fact, most of the people here, because there's only like 5 or 6 of you right now. That's okay. That'll change. We're watching my prep stream earlier today, where I was working on the exercises that I proposed last week. So the two exercises I proposed, the first one was listen to random conversations that happen around you throughout the week, and write down a bunch of lines that people say, and write a scene with those. So I did that one. I also did the music one that I proposed, where you take about 5 tracks, randomly shuffled through them, randomly shuffled from a library, and write a scene using those 5 songs. You get 1 veto if you really need it. You don't always, but sometimes you do. I actually had a bunch of my friends submit to a playlist, a Spotify playlist, specifically so I could do that. And it was really cool, because it's easy when it's your own music and you're familiar with it. It's much, much more interesting for stuff that you're not familiar with, because you kind of have to adapt it and gain perspective on certain stuff. So yeah, I'm going to show off some of that stuff that I worked on. So yeah, here. So this is the one I wrote. This is the wrong thing. Quotes. So here's my list of quotes. Did I text the wrong person? I learned how to drive standard loaded. I look better as a guy than a girl in these Snapchat things. Give me poetry, my peasants. She's gonna like hearts. Well, we'll see. Nah, man, we're identical. If Gabriel's lips were on this, I would. I thought you were here to serve us. I have a card to let me in if I go early or late. Paint your picture with his words. There's just so much going on in my mind. So I took these quotes and I saw a pattern and I started to rearrange them. So what I read from this was I read a pattern of poetry, specifically from the poetry line, but also when you talk about things like painting a picture and she's not gonna like hearts. So I laid out like this little bit of a framework of these quotes, and I started to fill in details of the scene I was setting. So I started out with a teacher in a creative writing class, and about 2 characters who are interacting. One who knows what he's writing, one who can't write. He's staring at the black page. So I filled that out, and I filled in little spots where the lines go. And, I started adding a little bit more flavor then. I added some drama, some tension, started to, No, Sam, you didn't say the poetry line. I actually stole it from Derek's drunk stream the other night when I got home from work. So I started adding tension. This specific section I've highlighted here where the character lies in order to kind of be supportive of his friend, but at the same time not to be, because he's scared to admit that he doesn't know what he's doing. And I started building this sort of fallacy. But it actually gets a little bit more interesting. When the Sam character volunteers to read his poem, and like how the class interprets that, and how they how much of a dysphoria there is between Sam and the other character, who's basically me. Right. And I'm gonna get to that, Johnny. In fact, right now. So in the second exercise, the one with the music, what I did was started out with REM, Losing My Religion. The five tracks are here on the side. Started out with Losing My Religion, and when he said the lines about the spotlight and saying too much and not saying enough, I really got a sort of melancholy vibe that was similar to what I was writing in the previous scene. And then I got the second track, which was I Found by Amber Run, and it had this line, it's like, I'll use you as a warning sign. So that really solidified the thought process for me, where I said, well, this is kind of Sam using Brendan as his warning sign. And the R.A.M. really worked with that, because it's kind of talking about, you know, the writing process, like expressing yourself. So I started writing this scene from Sam's perspective. I stole the first line from the previous from the other draft to write the beginning. And then the third song was Mona B. And the third song had very few lyrics. It really only had one or two choruses. They were kind of like halfway through the song, which is fine. It's actually a very good to have a mix of instrumental and lyrical music, because you can do a lot with the emotion and feel of a song. So in this case, what I did was there was a very bouncy, energetic song. So I kind of equated that with Sam walking to the front to read his piece, read his poetry out loud from the previous scene. And then there was this line, it's like, this is home where we are, that happened later on in the song as I was writing this. And that really gave me a sense of Sam knowing what he wants to do and being comfortable with his writing and where he is as a writer, and all that stuff. So that was that. So then next came Into the Darkness by the Phantoms, and that was a very tense song. It built a lot of tension. It was a little bit more metal. So I equated that with like the walk back with Brendan staring at Sam and kind of being like jealous of his friend, but not wanting to be a bad friend, and all that stuff. So then the last song, which was Moments, had this cool, like, I equated it earlier to a wave, where it has a build, but it never quite goes over the edge. So it kind of just like rolls up, and then rolls up, and then rolls up, and then lulls, and then rolls up, and I kind of got this like sensation of running away, of still keeping that sort of tension, not quite resolving things. So I kind of wrote this scene where this like section where Sam kind of escapes at the bell, sort of style thing. And I actually kind of really like this, so I'm probably gonna work on it a little bit on the side as a one single piece with the two scenes together. But yeah, like, so these are this is what I did with the exercises that I proposed last week. I'm pretty happy with the way that they turned out. And if anyone has anything, if anyone wants to share one that they worked on with me, just send me a PM on Twitch, or if I've gotten the link up properly yet, I'll send you the link to the Discord. You can post them on there, and I'll take a look and see what's what. And hopefully other people will comment as well. But we'll see how it goes. Yeah, so I'm pretty happy with these. They're not the most interesting writing I've ever done, but I think they have a lot of potential. I think there's a lot of character drama. Yeah. So, good stuff. Good stuff. Yeah. Sip of water. I mean, I suppose you're right, Johnny, that it does cause a lot of chaos, but, I mean, that's how drama is. Like, that's what causes drama, is chaos, and that's okay. Keeping in mind that, you know, what you put on the page for the first thing doesn't really matter, because you're going to, you can always change it later, right? Like, you can erase things and reconstruct. So a couple new people in the channel. I was just explaining the exercises I was doing earlier that I proposed in my last episode, which are kind of just like random generation of ideas. Through music and through overheard dialogue and stuff like that. So that's what I did there. Yeah. So it's 9:00. I think we're going to end it a little earlier this week as well, because we're still in theory week. Theory week 2. Yeah, what Smith Law says. Don't get it right, just get it written. You can get it right in the rewrite. Totally. Yeah. And what I was talking about is, like, when you asked about the chaos, right? That chaos is kind of important because it allows you a certain, it kind of forces you to put things in that you wouldn't necessarily have thought of, before. Right. It pushes you a little bit further than you like past your save point, and you can always dial that back later. Like, you can rewrite that. That's not a problem. You can move things around. You can get rid of entire things. But it's now you have ideas on the page and you can move around that stuff. So this was a short story just because it was part of the exercise. I also studied screenwriting. That's what I studied in college. So I totally get you, man. I do. And yeah, conflict equals drama. For sure. I will probably post versions of these drafts on my website, which is accidentalorigin.com, with the show notes and all that stuff as well. So that'll all be on there. Cause you know, I did the exercise as part of the show and it's important to show that. The last thing I'm going to do for today, is I'm going to go talk about the book club again. So, I'm going to go back to my big screen here. Boom. Yeah. So, for last week and this week, we're doing Brick by Brick by Stephen McCraney. I talked about this a lot earlier in the stream, because a lot of it was applicable to what I was trying to my notes for today. And, this book is fantastic. It's... it really gets deep into all the different aspects of being an artistic and creative person. It talks about things like procrastination, talks about things like creativity, inspiration, influences, how to learn properly, artistic lineage, all those good things. No problem, Johnny. It's primarily for me to learn just as much as it is for you guys to learn. So yeah, I love this book. I bought the full package as soon as I found it, because I was really inspired by one of the essays for many, many years, even though I didn't know who it was by. So I bought the book. I have the exercise book that comes with it. I have a couple posters. Actually, I'm going to show it here. I hope this isn't going to be... Oh, it's going to be kind of blown out. Steve McCraney signed it and drew an elephant in it, which is kind of like an in-joke in the book about the elephant. So there's totally... I bought that package. I love this. I swear by this book. It wasn't the original book I was going to do for the first book for the Accidental Book Club, but it's I'm glad I picked it because it has a lot more to do with creativity and the writing process, which is kind of what the first two episodes have been about. I don't have it nearby, sorry. Otherwise I'd show that book again, but it was a hell of fun. Actually, I will show that again because that's so totally relevant to what I'm talking about. Where did I put it? There we go. So last week on stream I was showing this, and I'll show this again, and it actually shows up much better with the new lights. But this is the boys' doodle book, and it's basically a series of drawing prompts. And this is fantastic when it comes to inspiration, right? Because it basically gives you a really good jumping off point for your process. And to be honest, I mean, these are equally good prompts for writing as they are for drawing. You know, they ask a very simple question, and building on that question is all about how you come to your artistic presence. And this is exactly what, like, those questions are exactly what I was talking about when I was talking about Flight and those really cool graphic novel anthologies. Where, you know, someone proposes a question and then a bunch of creative people come up with different answers in their own style, in their own way, with their own personal experiences. And, you know, a lot of anthologies are like that. I mean, I think of the really famous anthologies of Thieves' World by Robert Asprin and Wildcard by George R. R. Martin, what he did before he wrote Game of Thrones. And all that, where, you know, you get a bunch of people and you surround them with an idea and y'all just, you get all these different takes on that idea. And that's something I haven't really talked about. I did talk about kind of ideas of originality and all that stuff earlier, but, as much as I totally believe in the idea that there is no such thing as an original idea, not that that's a bad thing, but just that that's a thing, it's also one thing to say that if you give two writers the same story, they're not going to write it the same way. And that's again what I was talking about when I talked about that idea of originality, where perception, our presentation of an idea is what makes us original and not necessarily the idea itself. Because we're always building on that kind of stuff. No, I do not know the site art prompts, though I have heard a couple people discussing it. I'm going to write it down. And I'm a big believer in multidisciplinarianism, as I've talked about a few times over the last little while. And for me, art prompts are just as good as writing prompts for starting a writing story. In fact, in some ways, they can be better because they're not specifically designed for writers, and how you choose to interpret them is a much a much bigger mental stretch for you. It pushes you further. You learn more from doing it. Especially if it fails. And to the new guys in the room, a few new people, I'll reiterate it again for you, but failure is the first step of learning. The second step is analyzing your failure so you know why you failed. And I did write down that Reddit subgroup as well. I don't spend a ton of time on Reddit anymore. I didn't get into the community in the same way that a lot of people did. My friends were always really into it, so I know a lot about it. I've heard the writing communities there and some of the game dev communities are really, really good. And some of the art communities as well, from what I understand. I don't spend that much time on Reddit anymore. Brick by Brick, fantastic read. I actually tweeted Stephen McCraney today saying I was going to be talking about his book on stream. I hope he appreciates it because I said good things. Because this book inspired me a lot. It changed my process a lot. If there's any questions in the chat, anything you want to know about me, anything you want to know about the show, please feel free to ask. I am opening up to an open Q&A for a few more minutes, and then I'm going to do a quick episode recap and call it a night. Guy that just lost everything. How would you draw that, Dronny? In fact, Dronny, I challenge you. You linked me. This will be our exercise for the week. You linked me a site for art prompts. So what I'll do is I'll do a short piece using several art prompts. If you'll do several drawing or at least one drawing using writing prompts. We'll see what we can come up with. It'll be fun. Trust me. It down. It's official. It's in the show notes. No take backs. And that's all I ask. All I ask is that you try. Because like I keep saying, failure is the first step of learning. Thanks, Wordwin. I'm assuming that's how you pronounce that. Night, Dronny. Have a good night. I can't believe you caught both of my streams today. That's hardcore. I don't know how you sleep. thanks, Ruben. This is going to be a weekly stream every Sunday at 7 p.m. Eastern. I try and do a full episode of, like, I have a ton of show notes. I don't know if you can see them there. I take a topic and I talk about it. The first couple have been very theoretical, because I'm sort of at the beginning of the process. There's, last week I did creativity, this week I did inspiration and influence. Next week's probably going to be ideas. Next week's going to be more practical. I'm going to do a lot more writing on stream, a lot more things like mind maps and outlines and different ways of looking at that. And before I forget, the book for next week... the next book in the book club is going to be Sid Field's book on screenplay. I've read enough fantasy books with the word worm in them to really get that vibe of how to pronounce your name. So, yeah. But yeah, so next week we're going to be doing Sid Field's screenplay. Because it's a classic. And I really like what's... I really like what Sid Field says about John Renoir, and I've never actually read the entirety of it, and I really should. So, yeah, that's going to be the next one. And I'm very happy with myself. I didn't play with my pen at all until just right now. And yeah, you were saying you're a... you were saying you're a screenwriter as well, right, Smishmosh? Yeah. So, yeah, you read it. A few of the other books I have planned are Save the Cat, and also I might do the Screenwriter's Bible. I'm not sure if I will yet. It's on the it's one of the books I do own because I had it for class, and I kind of want to cover it, but it's kind of dry. I don't know. Maybe I'll spend only 1 week on that because it can kind of be covered like really quickly. And I also read most of it, so I can skim through a lot more of it. I don't have to spend as much time reading it as the others. But yeah. So what did I cover today? Today I covered ideas and influence. So as part of that, I talked about having an idea or generating one. I talked about brick by brick. Especially Taste is Your Teacher. How you gotta immerse yourself in what you're studying so you can get better at it. There is a the next one I covered from Brick by Brick was Be Friends with Failure, which I absolutely love. Which is to say, the more you study the great masters, the more you realize how much you suck, but that's okay, because you're learning. And the thing about those masters is they spent more time failing than you've spent trying. So you got to get there. You got to put in the work. There's no way around it. But you got to get out and just do it, you know? And then the last thing I covered was the art of stealing. How to use your influences to make yourself better and not just an imitator, a copier. Someone who doesn't think. So yeah, and then I covered the three ways to imitate: the naturalist, the scientist, and the DJ. I covered places to study, things to look at to help generate ideas and get influence and read new things and see new things. And then I covered what started out as 5, but actually ended up being 7 of my influences. You can see Osamu Tezuka in the back there and all that. So yeah, that's what I covered today. Just bring her to a close. I've been streaming for about 2 hours, 20 minutes, which is pretty good. I aim for at least 2.5 hours to 3 hours a night, or a week when I stream. So yeah, what kind of screenplays am I into writing? I haven't written a ton of screenplays. I've really written only 4, I think. 4 or 5? 4. Yeah, 4. So I wrote 1 horror short, 1 science fiction short, and then I wrote a, like, the screenplay that I wrote was a really weird science fiction puzzle drama comedy about a fictional tech company sort of thing. It's pretty cool. I want to finish it at some point, but we'll see how it goes. As part of my class, I wrote a couple of spec scripts for some shows and worked on an original show concept, which was this really crazy thing about magicians and goblins and stuff. Again, something I'm kind of working on, so I don't want to say too much. I'm pretty free with my ideas in general, but I just, like, I want to get a handle on it first before I start throwing out random stuff. I do write a little bit of fantasy. I've been writing mostly science fiction lately, mostly modern stuff. Yeah. I really like reading about creative people. So like, some of my favorite manga and movies and all that, are like, Beck, which is about a band, Trigger, which is about a band, movies about actors, stuff like that. So I actually really like, some of my concepts or a good portion of my concepts are actually about writers and creative people. Yeah, I'm Canadian. I'm from the East Coast. Well, I'm from Ontario. But yeah. It's one of those things where I think it depends on what I'm doing. Like what medium I'm writing in. I find with my short stories, they tend to be pretty science fiction. Whereas my novels tend to be about creative people. And my films tend to be kind of a mix of genres, but specifically genre films. So sci-fi, fantasy, horror, mystery, that kind of stuff. Graphic novels tends to be fantasy. I actually when I work on, I either work on fantasy or I work on superhero explorations. So non-traditional superhero stuff. More like Watchmen or like Black Summer. Oh, what was that one? Irredeemable. That series I absolutely love. Stuff like that. Jeff Lemire's Animal Man Run. I like that kind of stuff. That's what I work on when I work on comics. Yeah. So. Yeah. And I did see you similar. I hope I answered your question. I think I did. So yeah. It's a weekly show every Sunday at 7 p.m. Eastern. So there will be an episode next week. I might have to cancel the week after that because I think I'm going to a convention. It depends if I'm staying there all day or not. But yeah. And yeah, okay. That's cool, Smishmosh. I'm not a feel-good kind of guy. I'm a premise guy, so I like weird and strange premises, interesting settings, stuff that really drives stories in other than characters. Not that I'm particularly bad at characters, but they are one of my weaker points, I think. But yeah, I tend to go more settings, which ends up being more genre films. Than family films. So yeah, I think that's it for me today, guys. I'll see y'all next week. Check out my Twitter and my website. If you go to accidentalorigin.com, you'll see all the VODs of the previous episodes. This one will be up tomorrow. hey, I did not say kid stuff. I did not say kid stuff. I thought you meant family films as in like made for TV movie style family stuff. I'm totally into kid stuff. One of my favorite shows is iCarly, which I'm totally cool with admitting. I watched tons of cartoons. I was watching Yu-Gi-Oh yesterday, Yo-Kai Watch. I'm a huge fan of the Lego Spinjitzu series. Those are really, really cool. I love Lego in general. I actually can see about 15, 20 sets, some Transformers, a bunch of other stuff in here. So yeah, I'm totally into kid stuff. Like that's a non-issue for me. It's just more of, I thought you were referring to something else. But yeah, I don't judge. People are into things. Last week I was talking about how much I like Nora Roberts. Because I do. I think she's very good at what she does. So yeah. Yeah, man. Yo-Kai Watch is awesome. It's so well constructed. And they have like the continuing series like throughout it. Excellent. Excellent writing. Excellent puns and all their names and stuff. I'm a really big fan of Level 5, the company who actually made the game that Yo-Kai Watch is based on. They make some really good stuff. So yeah. Cool. All right. That's it for me. Yeah. So, yeah. You'll see the VODs on my website. There'll be show notes, links to videos or certain things that I've used as reference. I'll have excerpts of the stuff I read on screen, and stuff like that. That should all be up tomorrow by midnight-ish. Depends when I get around to it, but I do have a day off tomorrow, so I'll be working on it. Anyway, so that's it for me this week. My name is Brendan. This is Accidental Origin, and see y'all next time.